tonight, I want to share with you something that scientists and academics fear even more than loss of life or limb, and that is loss of reputation. So how do you fail without really trying? I want to share with you my collaboration with this incredible team out of Southampton University on an absolutely amazing archaeological site that challenged me in ways I never expected to be challenged and really showed me the possibilities and potential for using new technologies when you think you are at the end of your rope. Many of you have actually flown over this site, Portus, without even realizing it. If you've ever been to Rome and flown into the Fiumicino airport, you have flown over the site of Portus. Portus was the port of Rome during the height of the Roman Empire. The site of Portus is a very complicated landscape today. You have Rome Fiumicino Airport to the north. You have lots of houses. You have lots of fields, as you can see in this image. It's a mixed urban-rural landscape. And the archaeological team at Portus has been working there for over 30 years, led by Professor Simon Key, one of the great Roman landscape archaeologists in the world. So we decided to work together. Do you see the hexagonal basin? That was actually one of the central parts of the site of Portus. You can see a beautiful 3D reconstruction here. This is the main basin into which ships would sail. They would dock, leave their goods at the warehouses. They would be organized and then sent further on to the northeast, to Rome, and elsewhere within Italy. So I got a hold of some great high-resolution satellite imagery. I looked at a lot of previous publications from Professor Key and his team and got down to work with processing. That's what I do. And we started finding some really amazing things, which I want to share with you. We started finding buildings. We started looking at things that may not otherwise be visible by using the infrared part of the light spectrum. We were able to tease out old roads. We were able to tease out buildings, different areas of shading that potentially could be other warehouses or other structures. And things really started appearing. I started getting so excited. So these were sent on to Professor Key and his team, except there was a problem. They knew about all of them. Now, my ego shrunk down to atom size. And I talked to Professor Key on the phone, and I said, I don't understand. What have I missed? He goes, we just haven't published any of those yet. We saw them all with aerial photography. And I thought, well, there goes technology. They already knew about them. What was I to do? Well, around that time, I started looking through this high-resolution satellite imagery company called Digital Globe. I started looking through their satellite database, and I noticed this brand new satellite image that hadn't been in the database before. And so we got a hold of this brand new satellite imagery. Now, Portus is this amazing site. So not only do you have all of these warehouses and buildings and roads that they'd so carefully mapped out for so long, but there was this big mystery. Simon Key and his team had spent over 30 years looking for an amphitheater. A site of this size, filled with so many people who were living and processing all the goods from all over the Roman Empire, there would have been incredible wealth at a site like Portus. And for the wealthy inhabitants of Portus, many of whom likely lived in Ostia, they would have needed a place to go be entertained. Think of it like a combination of an ancient movie theater and sports complex, much like what you saw in Gladiator, although on a slightly smaller scale. Where was the missing amphitheater of Portus? Now, Simon and his team had told me, well, it's probably somewhere in the southern part of the site. We really don't know where it is. It may not even exist. So we got a hold of this brand new satellite data and started processing it. Some interesting things started appearing. To the east of the Tiber, this is a before and this is an after image, you can see in that arrow, it's pointing to a small band about 7 to 8 meters wide. And we sent out a team to do subsurface survey, and what they found was a canal. And one of the long-standing questions that they had at the site of Portus was, how in the heck do you transport all these goods just along the Tiber itself, you would have had log jams. And what we're able to suggest now that we found this new feature, which is a canal or a smaller river that would have probably led up to Rome, is that they would have had these smaller channels to divert traffic. So it would have been a way for them to have better organization of transportation. So as I was processing the data, something came up. So this is a before image. This is an after. You see an interesting oval feature with linear features running from east to west. Now, I admit, when I first got a hold of the data, and when I first started processing it, and when I first saw this feature, I thought that has got to be modern, or at least 100 or 200 years old. It's probably some old ditch or drainage feature, something to do with local agriculture. The idea that it could be this missing amphitheater was the absolute last thing on my mind. I had been so humbled by the utter lack of discovery from our previous work, I thought best to just not even say anything. I'll send the Portis team an image and just let them tell me that once again, I absolutely do not know what I'm talking about. Well, when Professor Key saw this image, I was told, and quote, he fell out of his chair. When I talked to him on the phone, he said, I can't believe what you might have found. This is extraordinary. This could help us to rewrite the history of how we understand the landscape around Portus. Previously in this area, they'd found a number of mortuary features. So again, a before and an after. This feature, this ovoid feature, is 40 by 40 meters in size, with an eastern and a western gate, with a clear east-west road. And you can see just to the north, there's a series of outbuildings. Typically, around an amphitheater, you're going to have rooms or places where people dress or practice or prepare for whatever activities are going to take place in the amphitheater, whether they're fighting or whether they're staging a play, whatever's going on there. They knew about none of this. And what's even more extraordinary is that the Portis team had done subsurface survey already and found nothing. One of our favorite sayings in archaeology is absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. They hadn't used the right tools. Now, flipping that around, the satellites didn't find a lot of things that they had found on the ground using other tools. So what this taught me, it was this amazing lesson. We have to be strategic about when and where we use certain technologies, and we have to understand the landscapes in which we work. Just because nothing has ever been found in a particular place doesn't mean that the right angle or the right picture or the right new sensing technology won't be able to find it. And this particular discovery is allowing us, it's not just finding something, which of course is cool, one of the reasons I'm an archaeologist, but it actually allows us to ask better questions about the site. Why was this there? Why was this particular feature placed so prominently in a landscape that had so many mortuary features? What does that say about the relationships between the living and the dead? And honoring their memories, were there festivals held there? Were there activities done at this particular place that honored the memory of the deceased and so on? We also found road extensions. We found old river courses along the Tiber. We found numerous other features that we simply hadn't found because we looked differently. You've got to sometimes, when you're absolutely unsure of what to do, it was only through that just being completely down and being in a gutter that I was able to look up and think a little bit more clearly. And that is what I would challenge all of you to do the next time that you think you are at the end of your rope. Sometimes you don't need to look down, sometimes look up. And I just want to thank National Geographic for having me here, the National Science Foundation for generously funding my research, and you can follow me at Indie from Space. Thank you very much.